It was the best of times. It was the worst of times.
Hold on there. This isn't the Tale of Two Cities.
Sorry about that. But it is a classical book, you know.
Were bitchin', and most of us thought we would run forever.
The year was 1966.
We were young. We were hot.
We had the spirit of the Beach Boys, the soul of Ike and Tina Turner.
And for sure, we were absolutely going places. Some of us were college bound.
Others just a little nervous about the draft.
As for the rest, well, we jumped headfirst into the real world of work, marriage, and parenthood.
And regardless of where we thought we were heading, we all secretly shared more than little apprehension about what the future would hold. 20 years later.
Yes, Carla, it's been that long.
We now can look back and laugh about those days. Because the bottom line is, no matter what you did after January or June of 1966, you'll never, ever have to relive those lazy, crazy days spent at good old Southwest High School. And I won't be back to forget if I find me a new girl. Journey with us now as we step back in time. Guys wore their hair short.
And we girls love to tease our hair.
The preferred car to drive was a Chevy. Any Chevy, as long as it had a four barrel.
The best makeout music was Johnny Mathis, and the hottest new movie character was a guy named James Bond.
Well, you know you make me wanna talk.
Back then, our student body was 2,300 strong.
The January class packed this stage with all 153 grads to get one of these and say goodbye. And the January class gift is still there.
Unfortunately, the June class gift was stolen.
This place was also the setting for such memorable musicals as Carousel, stage plays like The Importance of Being Earnest, and some very strange
but creative
performances like George Schroll's Dracula Goes to High School. Regardless of the show, the place was always packed.
Say, let's not forget Hello Days.
Remember these? Kinda stirs the blood in your veins, doesn't it?
Who could forget the agony in your freshman year? Wondering if anyone would really bother signing your tags. And worse yet, we let seniors talk us into buying 50 more tags than we really needed.
Were we dorks or what?
Well, time and traditions have changed, but the nightmares persist. Take, for instance, the first time you went to your library. Right 38, left 22, right 27, piece of cake. More than a little frustrated, you resorted to the old standard of opening.
By the time you had 720 lunches and 5,000 class periods under your belt, you were in control.
Adolescent hormones were in overdrive. And what you'd give to unravel the mysteries of S.E.S. Some among us were real heavy hitters, making great moves and, but maybe pushing it a little bit too far.
As for the rest, well, you could always look, dream, and crave for something to come your way. And usually it didn't.
I wonder what it was like to be a legend in your own time. Turning back on his best friend if he put her down. When a man loves a woman, spend his very last dime trying to hold on. Somehow we survived. Yes, we did make the long, painful transformation from gullible, awkward freshmen to the conniving, devious, and self-assertive seniors.
Yeah,
After 4 years of hanging out, some of us learned how to boogie. Or was the term rock out?
If you really knew how to dance, you did the Imperial.
If you were a girl, there was always the security of a line dance.
And if you had no shame or rhythm, you threw your arms and legs all over the place and did the mashed potatoes, the dog, or the appropriately called dance step, the jerk.
Well, whatever you did, it was a real workout. And speaking of workouts, remember this place? And how about our wonderful PE teachers that helped us build character through sweat equity? Let's face it, if it weren't for the Don Ashleys, we could all have grown up to be out of shape nerds and bimbos.
And ladies, let's not forget those snazzy blue gym suits. Where was that form-fitting aerobic wear when we needed it?
Let's talk about sports.
Must we?
Back in 1964, they turned our wonderful track out front into a quadrangle and gave us a football field out back. It was here that the Fighting Southwest Longhorns went 1-for-9 in 1965.
Not what you'd call a winning season.
Well, maybe so. But then look at some of these statistics. Not to mention the primitive equipment we had to work with. Mr. Gladstone wanted an intelligent, quick, lean, mean killing machine.
But what he got was a meandering, green, swinging machine. Face it, we had more guys who wanted to be charming and well-groomed than Neanderthals.
Well, the basketball team was slightly more respectable, with 11 wins and 11 losses.
The big question was, can white boys really hope to play on the same court with JoJo White and get any respect?
Was there a winning team at Southwest? You bet. Before jogging and 10K runs became fashionable, there was a sport called cross country. Inside of this thundering herd of athletes, our boys managed to emerge victorious to take the 1966 state cross country championship. Thousands, maybe tens or 20, cheered on our boys, and they were led by none other than our enthusiastic cowgirl cheerleaders. It was a real big deal.
Particularly if you were on the team. As for tennis, track, and baseball, do any of us really care? Only kidding, guys. For every jock that aspired to make a team sport, there were 20 smarter guys and gals spending their time studying and getting involved in more intellectual endeavors.
In hindsight, it's probably fair to say that we all wanted to study harder. But what the hell? With kids like Stephen Kozak, Doug Newley, Bob Schmidt,
and Don Ettinger, Joanne Propacek, and Linda Pillard, what was the point? These folks were born with brains, and there were only so many A's to go around.
Do you hear that curve?
Say, remember all the practical advice for living bestowed on us by the science department?
Oh, yes. Who could ever forget the table of periodic elements or Mr. Ellerman's tips on how to use a beer can opener as a weapon?
What about the anti-smoking lectures that Mrs. Medlock gave us? Didn't she know that you can't be cool unless you smoke?
And besides, would you go out with someone who chewed gum and blew bubbles? Hey, and speaking of smoking, did you ever wonder why Mr. Young, our principal and man of distinction, smoked his cigarettes like this?
We can only speculate. Which is something we did a lot of in the cafeteria. Despite what they served us, lunch was the social hour of the day. It was a time to catch up with friends and talk trash.
For just a few lunch checks, you could get just about anything imaginable. And sometimes it took a great deal of imagination to know what it was you were eating. Besides, there was always the ever-popular, solid standby, hot buns with butter. Butter and just a little more butter. Were they good? Oh, so very, very good.
But at least I have you. How can you walk out knowing?
When we weren't busy stuffing our faces, we spent our time cruising the south side of town. On summer days, the place to be was Ted Drew's home of the delightful drink called a concrete.
At night, it was steak and shim. Actually, steak was probably the first yuppie hangout in St. Louis. We just didn't know it. And even if you only could get the family car for one night a week, for only 1 hour, you definitely had to make the scene at stake. It's changed some. New sign, new buildings. And hey, look, they don't make the car hops wear uniforms anymore.
Well, we could go on and on, but we have to save something for the 30th year reunion.
That's about it. So, get out of here.
And hey, let's be careful out there.